It's springtime and the flowers are blooming and they're all calling pollinators to come and visit. But how do they make a call without even making a sound? Hi, and welcome to the Lawrence at Home. My name is Bia and I'm one of the teachers at the Lawrence Hall of Science. This is the part two of our investigation of how well adapted our flowers and our pollinators. If you haven't yet, make sure to check out part one, linked in the description below, where we learn about the purpose of a flower and introduce the relationship between flowers and their pollinators. In this episode, we'll explore how flowers attract their pollinators and do an activity to design a pollinator of our own. Before we get started with today's investigation, make sure to hit that subscribe button and give this video a like so you never miss a cool science video like this one. Now that we know more about the relationship between flowers and their pollinators, we can start exploring how are they well adapted to one another. Flowers have many adaptations that call their pollinators to come visit. And in the same way, pollinators have adaptations that make them well suited to visit a certain type of flower. To explore more of this idea, we're going to investigate how the shape, color, pattern, smell, and time of opening of flowers influence which pollinators they can be visited by. Let's begin with shape. The shape of a flower tells us which pollinator can come visit them. Pollinators like butterflies need a sturdy landing pen so they can stand on while they collect the nectar. Other pollinators like hummingbirds are more well suited for pollinating flowers that are long and deep that otherwise couldn't be accessed by a bumblebee, for example. Flowers with daytime visitors need a way to stand out from the leaves that are all around them, so they usually have very bright colors that call to their pollinators. A lot of insects don't have the ability to see the color red, so we might see that they are more attracted to flowers with colors like yellow and blue. Some flowers have special patterns that help guide their pollinators to where the nectar is. Those patterns are called nectar guides. Some insects like bees have the ability of detecting UV light, so some flowers even have nectar guides that are invisible to the human eye, but definitely visible to the bee's eyes. Nectar guides work as target landing pads that tell the pollinators exactly where the nectar is, which happens to be exactly where the pollen is too, that they will transport from one flower to the next. Now moving on to smell. Some flowers attract their pollinators through their sense of smell, and different pollinators have different preferences. Bees and wasps are usually attracted to sweet smells, while flies actually prefer the smell of rotting meat. Beetles usually prefer spicy and sweaty smells, and bats are usually attracted to sweaty or fruity smells. The last thing we want to consider is the flower's time of opening. Does your flower open during the daytime or the nighttime? Depending on the answer, it will be visited by animals that are awake on the day or nocturnal animals that are awake during the nighttime. On the daytime, flowers usually attract their pollinators by things like colors and patterns, while in the nighttime, they usually have very pale colors and attract their pollinators through smell. Now, for today's activity, it is your turn to design your own pollinator. For this activity, you will use the handout available on the video description. You can use a digital copy, or you can print it out, or if you don't have a printer like me, you can just make your own table on a separate piece of paper, and that will work just fine. Other things you're going to need is something to draw on, something to draw with, and your creativity. The first step is to pick a flower. I just went outside in my neighborhood and I found this flower that I will use for this activity. If you don't have access to any real flowers at this moment, you can look up some pictures of flowers online. I will put some suggestions in the description below. Now, to our second step is to study our flower. What is the shape and color of your flower like? Does it have a smell? Can you identify the flower parts inside of your flower? Take a moment, study your flower, and add a few notes to your table. And I will do the same as an example.
Instead of printing out the handout, I decided to make a table on a separate paper. So I set up two columns, one to record the traits of my flower, and the other one to later plan out the traits of my pollinator. Then, I moved on to listing my observations about the flower. The first thing I noticed was that it had a long and deep tube-like shape. It was about the same thickness and length as my pointer finger. I used a pencil to measure how deep it was. The flower I picked had red petals on top connected to a yellow tube. It had a narrow opening about the size of a dime. I could identify the stamen and pistil close to the opening on top. I could see the pollen on the stamen, and the stigma at the top of the pistil had two flaps where the pollen could stick to. And finally, since I picked my flower in the daytime and it was open, I noted that it was open in the daytime.
Now, our next step is to imagine what kind of pollinator could visit that flower. Based on the shape, color, pattern, smell, or time of opening of your flower, what kind of pollinators could visit it? Does it have a sturdy landing pad? What colors does it have? Does your pollinator have any special organs that allow it to access the nectar or detect the flower through smell or sight? How big or small is your pollinator? Now, use the second column of your template to make some notes about the design of your pollinator.
The first trait that came to my mind was that since the flower has a deep tube, the pollinator, if it was a bird, should have a long beak, and if it was an insect, a long proboscis to access the nectar at the base of the flower. Next, since the flower was open in the daytime, the pollinator would be a daytime visitor. Then, I remembered that when I was studying the flower, I saw ants inside, and I realized that the pollinator would need a long beak or proboscis if it's big, but the flower could also be visited by small pollinators that can go all the way inside the tube, like the ants. Then, I thought about whether or not my pollinator would need to detect smell, and I realized that I didn't make any notes about that when studying my flower. But it's okay, I tried to smell it and could not detect any scents, so I noted that it had no smell in the flower column and thought that whether or not my pollinator could detect smells does not play a role in determining whether or not it could visit this particular flower. After that, I thought that since the part of the flower that contains the nectar is yellow, my pollinator should be able to detect that color. But in retrospect, I think that if the pollinator was not an insect, it would also make sense for it to detect the color red as well. But I didn't add that to my table at the time. My last thought about my pollinator is that it should have some fuzz for the pollen to stick to when it visits the flower for nectar. And just like that, I was done with my table and ready to move on to the next part of the activity.
Now, we're going to try to make some connections between our observations on the first and second column of our table. Each of the traits of your pollinator is linked to a trait of your flower, and show these connections on your table by linking one trait to another when that connection exists.
I thought having a long and deep tube shape was linked to two possible pollinator traits, having a long beak or proboscis if it's big, and being able to go inside if it's small. Then I linked having a yellow tube to the pollinator's ability to detect yellow, since that's where the nectar is located. After that, I thought that having the stamen and pistil on the opening of the flower could be linked with the pollinator's need to have some kind of fuzz for the pollen to stick to. The fact that our flower opens at daytime is linked to our pollinator being a daytime visitor. Another flower trait that can be linked to that is that it has no smell. Remember, daytime flowers can rely on color and patterns to attract pollinators, as opposed to nighttime flowers that need to rely on smell. Lastly, I also connected the fact that the flower has a narrow opening to our two possible pollinator designs.
Now you are ready to draw your pollinator. Based on your notes, it's time to create an image of your pollinator and give it a name. And make sure to also add your flower to your drawing. You can draw the flower or you can stick the real flower to your masterpiece using glue or some tape.
Now it's the time to use your creativity and create your own pollinator. Flowers can often be pollinated by more than one animal, so there are probably multiple possibilities for your design. Or you can even choose to design multiple pollinators for your one flower. Use your notes on the pollinator column to guide your design. I decided to go with a bird as my pollinator, so I designed a hummingbird with a curved beak to go with the shape of the flower's tube. I called it the angled hummingbird. Then I also labeled the parts of my pollinator that make it well adapted to visit my flower, linking the traits from my pollinator column to the corresponding structures in my pollinator drawing. You can use any materials you have available for drawing and coloring your pollinator. Be as creative as you like and have fun imagining all the different possibilities for your design.
If you want to share your art with us, ask an adult to share it on Instagram and don't forget to tag us at Berkeley Science. Now you have created your own pollinator that is very well adapted to pollinate the flower that you chose. Good job! Now, if you're still curious to learn more about flowers and pollinators, we did an interview with our friends from Planet Bee, and you can find a link to that in the description below. In that interview, we talk about why are bees so important to us, discuss what it's like to be a beekeeper, and come up with a few strategies that we can do as both individuals and communities to help protect the bees. And that, my friends, brings us to the end of today's video. Thank you so much for joining me in learning more about the relationship between flowers and their pollinators. I hope that you too get to try out our activities at home. Once again, my name is Bea, and thank you so much for watching. Make sure to like and subscribe, and I'll see you next time here at the Lawrence at Home.